so let me just throw this out there. You worship how God called you to worship. First of all, there's no judgment in this house. This is God's house. There will be judgment one day, but Jesus does the judging, okay? Not us, all right? The other thing I need to tell you is we're glad to have you. So glad to have every one of you. All right.
Systems that's in here right now, and we're going to try to make it a more cinematic experience for the people around the nation or whoever watches for that case. So be sure to drop your change in up there. Make sure to get your kiddos involved in Wednesday night class, man. There's so much stuff that goes on Wednesday nights. I know this past couple weeks they've been doing stuff for Father's Day, so we're excited about that. Excited to see what all gains. Have you got some good stuff for me for Father's Day? No? Okay. Well, fantastic. Hope your kids got you something good for Father's Day out there. That's always a good thing. But make sure to get them involved on Wednesday nights. Bless the small business for May. Went to before and after Solana Spa. There's the address. We'll do June here just pretty soon. So be in prayer for that as well. Father's Day is June 19th, which is next Sunday. So invite your dad out or invite somebody in your life that's been a father figure, whether it be a dad, a granddad, an uncle, whatever it may be. Invite them out to church next Sunday just so we can say, hey, thank you so much for helping get these rowdy, ruckus people up in the church house. Amen? Amen for that. Okay. Fruition Fireworks on July 4th. Be in prayer for that. We always do a fireworks show that gets better every single year. So be in prayer for that. That's right around the corner. We'll get an address and a time and stuff for you. Throw that up there before too long. And Kids Takeover is July the 31st. Kids Takeover. What that means is that the Children of Fruition, in which you see a lot of them scattered out through here, the Children of Fruition are going to do a whole entire complete service for us on the July the 31st. Amen. Amen. So they'll be singing, they'll be preaching, they'll be leading altar call, and I'm telling you right now, if this altar's not full, we're shutting it down. I'm just saying, we are locking the doors until everybody gets a prayer on this altar. That's Sunday. Amen? Amen. No, I'm just playing. I want y'all to come out and support, though, because these kids have been doing a lot, man. They've been practicing, they've been singing, I'm telling you, man, it's going to be a good time, so you need to come out and support for that. Amen?
Yeah.
Amen. www.fruitionchurchky.org, that is the website where everything goes through. If you want to know more about who we are, what we do, what we're about, all that good jazz, go to that website right there. And the Everyday Christian Podcast is what we do through the church. It comes out every Tuesday night, Wednesday morning, just whenever you want to listen to it, about 30, 35 minutes long. And it helps break down the sermon from the week before and helps you just, you know, to kind of understand it a little more clearly. So thank you for the support of that. Nick threw me some stats the other day that I don't remember in my head. But we've reached about 10 countries, about 30 states, something like that, so far. So 30 states within the U.S., 10 countries around the world, to be able to tell people about Jesus and stuff like that. So that's pretty amazing as well. We're very thankful for that. Very thankful for that. So without further ado, tithes and offerings, we always say give back to God as God has given unto you. Oh, I'm sorry. One more thing from all my stuff up here in the front row. That's how they know if you're preaching or teaching good. Every year, we do First Friday down on the square, which is the back to school bash. They have First Friday every month, but they do a specific First Friday for back to school. And basically what we do is we collect school items to go ahead and pass out. And last year, I think we probably blessed about close to 200 kids.
Yes.
It was crazy, man, the people that came through the line. And so I think we're pretty much known by now as the giving church. You know, we don't set on money. We use money to better the community. That's what we're about. But either way, here's what we're asking. This is what we're going to do this year. We're going to make a crayon box that's got stuff in it. So it's pencils, markers, glue, crayons, erasers. Pretty simple stuff, straightforward. And a notebook. So, if you want to get supplies, the box, or the notebook, whichever you want to do, we'll be doing that all the way up until, I don't even know what the first Friday in August is. But, look on your calendar. I'll get you a date for that next week too. Amen? But we'll have it up here on the side, bring in some supplies for that as well, so we can bless the kids of the community. Now, it's time for tithes and offerings. So, let's pray. And then we'll be back to worship. Lord, we love you. We thank you. Lord, we're thankful to be in the house today. Lord, we just pray that you prep this moment, this atmosphere that we're in right now, Lord, that you begin to work and move in every heart and every life that's here, Lord. From young to old, it does not matter. Lord, I just pray that in this time and in this moment that we have together, that people came in here today not to just come to church, but to be a part of church. Not to just come in and sit down, but to get involved and get connected to the kingdom of God, to help build, to help outreach, whatever it may be, Lord. But I just pray, speak and believe, that by the time people leave today, that they'll know that Jesus loves them, we love them, and they can accomplish great things through His purpose and through His name. And Lord, we love you, we thank you. Bless these tithes and offerings. Bless those that can give, those that cannot give, Lord. Bless each and every household represented. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen and amen. Bring your tithes and offerings, and let's get back to worship this morning. Thank you.
and your goodness today. Even when it doesn't appear that you're working and moving and that you are good, you are. You are good. You are always good. You're always good.
But the blood of
in unity. Could you just lift your voices to heaven today? If you're a believer in Christ, just lift your voice.
Joshua directed them, cross to the middle of the Jordan and take your place in front of the chest of God, your God. Each of you heft a stone to your shoulder, a stone for each of the tribes of the people of Israel, so you'll have something later to mark the occasion. And when your children ask you, what are these stones to you? You'll say, the flow of the Jordan was stopped. The flow of the Jordan was stopped in front of the chest of the covenant of God as it crossed the Jordan, stopped in its tracks. These stones are a permanent memorial for the people of Israel. And the people of Israel did exactly as Joshua commanded. They took 12 stones from the middle of the Jordan, a stone for each of the 12 tribes, just as God had instructed Joshua, and carried them across with them to the camp and set them down there. And Joshua set up the 12 stones taken from the middle of the Jordan that had marked the place where the priest who carried the chest of the covenant had stood. Listen to this. They are still there today. They're still there today. Let's pray. Lord. Lord, we thank you. We praise you. Lord, we glorify you. Lord, the moments and the times that we have inside of this place, let us not take them for granted. Lord, we come here to be a part of a family. We come here to see people. We come here to fellowship. But we also come here to worship. We come here to learn. We come here to grow. Lord, we come in here to seek your presence. We come in here to be refueled and recharged for the next week that we're about to face, for the next moments that we're about to face. We know the enemy's been defeated, but that does not deter him from trying to distract us trying to manipulate us, trying to get us to make and go backwards, make bad decisions and go backwards. So Lord, as we're in here and in these moments together, let us focus upon you. Let us focus upon the Word. Let us focus upon the presence of God. And know that we can leave this place better than when we walked in this place. Lord, we love you. We thank you. We praise you. We honor you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. And amen. And amen. Give you a hand clap of praise before you're seated this morning. My kids. Y'all get going. Y'all move. Y'all go. Y'all get to where you need to go. Quick, fast, and in a hurry. Look, everybody's like, I don't know. Just go somewhere. Just go somewhere. If you're in a kids' class today, we're going over here to the right-hand side. If Skylar and Kaylin still have all that long hair left afterwards, you did not do your job today as kids. Amen. 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 And amen. Everybody have a good week? Man, I tell you what, it's been a good week. It has been a good week.
Even if you would just allow me this morning, I just want to give God praise and thanks.
Amen.
Your family and my family has took it to baby girl.
Amen.
She's been in the hospital since Wednesday, and God took care of everything.
Mm-hmm.
I thank you once again for just watching prayers, for answering prayers. We have a prayer.
Amen. 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 Miss Karen is right. Andrea's brother, and and Miss Karen's niece are married, and they just had a beautiful, beautiful baby. She's been in the hospital for some time, but as far as I know, everything is good and healthy and good to go. So praise God for that. Praise God for that situation. Amen. Let's talk about rocks to remember. Rocks to remember. And while I'm doing that, I want everybody in this house today that's sitting here right now, Alex, you do you, bro, however you want to do it. I want everybody in this house to grab a rock really quick. Now, if anybody wants to... Three songs deep into worship, and he's like... You ask him to do one thing, he's like, I'm busy. What? Dude, this is church. You can't be busy. What are you talking about? What are you doing? You got more buckets. You're going to spread it out. So you saying I need two more people real quick? Two more people? We need two more people? Man, okay. Man. Hey, look at that. We got volunteers everywhere. Hey, I tell you what, bathrooms need to be cleaned after church. We got some stuff that need to be done. While they're passing that out, I want to talk to you about rocks to remember, but I also want you to have a rock today, because I think what we do with the rocks that we have is very, very, very important. Through the Old Testament, you will find, as they're passing out these rocks, through the Old Testament, you will find that more times than not, they used rocks to do what? To build altars with. They would build altars out of rocks, and then they would bow down and they would worship. They would praise. They would pray, whatever the case was. But wherever they were at, they would build an altar, which led me to believe, and this is why we have to understand this today and get this concept, that church is not a building per se. Church is whenever you can come together and make it happen. Church is in your car. Church is on the street. Church is at your job. Church is in the bathroom. Church is wherever you want church to be at. As long as you invite the presence of God in. As long as the presence of God is there, you can have church at any moment, any time, any place. It's not scheduled to just Sunday at 11:15 or Wednesday at 7:15. But whenever you come in, church is church whenever you invite the presence of God into the place. So, we find that going through Scripture. But at this moment, I want you to get this. They are finally crossing over the last thing that is keeping them out of the promised land. We'll get to the walls of Jericho and all that good stuff here probably in the next week or so, maybe Wednesday night. But the final body of water that was keeping them out of the promised land was the Jordan River. And you have to remember that this is the new generation of Israelites that Moses had charged, that Joshua had taken over, and now they're about ready to walk in and walk over. So they don't really remember the miracle of the Red Sea. They don't really remember God parting the sea and walking through on dry land. They've heard about it. It's good stories and all of that good stuff. But now they're seeing God do something miraculous in the present. Now, if you remember about the Red Sea was just parted. The Red Sea, it was held, it was parted, so water was on both sides, but they walked through on dry land. Now, if you look at the miracle of the Jordan, the Bible says that the miracle at the Jordan was that God began to hold the flow of the river from upstream. God began to just hold it. And then whenever I'm looking, you have to do a little bit of research right here. You have to understand how far he held it. Now, there's a lot of Bible scholars that are like, you know, we can't really, you know, put a specific number on it. But if you go back and do some research, the spot of where he held it at, how far, is anywhere from about 18 to 30 miles. 18 to 30 miles of just dry land of where God held, and then there was dry points of where they could go across. Now, how good is God this morning that he can cause a river to stop flowing long enough for you to cross over to where you need to be at? How good is God this morning that he can literally, God will stop at nothing to get you to your destiny. Did you know that? God will stop at nothing. God will stop at nothing. If there's a mountain, he'll move it. If there's a river, he'll stop it. If there's a sea, he'll part it. If there's a giant, he'll kill it. I mean, like, let's talk about this. God is so good that he will allow nothing to stand in your way. The question is, what will you allow to stand in your way? Will you walk through the dry land? Will you trust God through the process? Whenever something is bigger than what you are, do you trust that process? We're dealing with a new group, a new age of people right here. And so I like it because he wakes Joshua up and he says, Joshua, get everybody ready. Get everybody prepared because today's going to be the day that I prove who I am to you. Today's going to be that day. And so he gets everybody up. He gets them down to the Jordan. And then there are specific instructions. Specific instructions. You let the covenant of God, the chest of God, you let that go first. You let that go first. The presence of God goes first. So, after the presence of God goes, then you go. Then you go as the presence of God goes. So, let me ask you a question. It's easy. Well, I ain't going to say it's easy. But it's easier to follow the presence of God whenever it is in front of you. Whenever the presence of God is leading you, it's easy to follow along the way. But whenever the presence of God or the Ark of the Covenant got to the edge of the Jordan, the instructions were for the Ark of the Covenant, for the Levitical priest to stop and put their feet at the edge of the Jordan and not to go any further. Not to go any further. Now, you're good with following God up to the point of where now you're standing at the edge of the Jordan. And now you're standing at the edge of the Jordan, and now the instruction is for you to keep going while the presence of God stays still. Now, it's easy to follow God when God's in front of you, but can you trust God when God's behind you? Can you trust God when he's bringing up the rear? Can you trust God when he's on your backside? Can you trust God now at this moment where the miracle is happening before you, but now God is behind you? Man, that makes it difficult because at some moments in times we always want to just say, Lord, I want to stay where you are. I want to stay in the presence. I want to stay here. Listen. I want you to get this today. If we literally just stayed in here 24/7, nothing would change out there. If we stayed in here all the time, if we stayed, man, it would be good. We could get fed. It'd be wonderful. We'd get donuts. We'd get stuff. I mean, it'd be great. Like, everybody just be a walking diabetic coma, probably. I mean, before it was all said and done. But as we're getting fed in here, nothing is happening out there. It's where we, like, Lord, I love to be in your presence. But at the same point in time, there's a million people with problems out there. And so we have to trust that while we're in the presence, we're getting what we need in here in order to be effective out there.
And so as the Levitical priest, as the Ark of the Covenant is standing at the edge of the Jordan at this very moment, something begins to happen. As soon as their feet touches the edge of the water, the river begins to stop flowing. The river begins to stop flowing. I don't know if you've ever seen anything like that happen in your life. If you've ever seen a miracle where just all of a sudden everything stops and then you're like, my goodness gracious. It puts into perspective how big God is. Like, we thank Him over $10 sometimes. We thank Him over an electric bill. We thank Him that our car's got gas in it, things like that. But can I tell you, those things right there are just so small, so minute to God, that God can do some crazy, crazy stuff in your life that is bigger than what you could ever think, believe, or imagine. That's what Ephesians 3:20 says. But if we believe that God can actually do it, I think our minds can be blown as to what God can do. As to what God can do. He is standing. The presence of God is standing on the edge of the Jordan. And now there's dry land that begins to appear. There is dry land that begins to appear because God will stop at nothing to get you to your destiny. Oh, man. Now, the instruction is for while the presence of God is at the edge, you go on through. You go on through. Is this a setup? Probably. Probably. God is pushing you on through. God is trying to get you to go on through to the other side because there's promises, there's destiny, there's things on the other side that's been waiting for you, but now the presence of God is not before you, it's behind you. And He's instructed you to keep moving forward. I want to tell you that it is a great compliment when the presence of God moves from the front of you to the rear of you. It's a great compliment. Why? Because at this moment, God has now instilled enough faith inside of you that now you're leading the charge. You're leading the brigade. I want you to have enough confidence and faith within yourself today, ladies and gentlemen. I'm not talking about a pride issue today. I'm talking about having enough faith in what God has given you. Enough faith in the ability that you have. And enough faith that what God has blessed you with inside of your body, your instincts, your mind. Have enough faith in that God has granted you what you need to get to the other side. That if God is behind you and He's saying go, that now you're ready. Now you're ready. I've taught you everything you need to know. When God says it's time to go, it's not the fact that He's letting you go. He's moving you forward. Right. He's moving you forward. He's that mama bird that's just kicking you out of the nest. It's time to go. It's time to fly. It's time to learn. When God says go, take it as a compliment. Whenever Jesus looked at the disciples and He said, what? Go into all the earth. Go into all the nations. Go and spread the gospel. He was instilling confidence in them. I've taught you everything that I know. Now go. Now go. The presence of God will always be here, but now go. This is where you should always come back to recharge, to revamp. This is where you should always come back to find rest and peace. But go. Because there's more out there. So the presence of God stays at the edge. Why does it stay at the edge for? Because as long as the presence of God is at the edge, the water stays parted. The water stays parted. Why would God set you up? Why would God drown you for? You see, a lot of times we get focused so much. Is this water going to hold? Is this water going to stay? Is God setting me up? Am I going to drown? Am I hesitating? Am I spending too much time? We get so caught up in the questions. We get so caught up in the how-to. We get so caught up in how it's going to happen, where it's going to happen, when it's going to happen, how much time. We get so caught up in, am I going to miss the mark of what God is trying to do? What God is trying to do, we're just going to mess it up somehow, some way. We're going to mess it up. But can I tell you today, the focus is not on the presence behind you or the waves beside you. The focus is on the promises in front of you. The focus is on the promises in front of you. Watch this. Your promises never move closer. You move closer to the promises. It's not like God's like, here are the promises, and you're over here, and it's like,
All right, I'm just going to stand here and the Lord's going to bring the promises to me. It doesn't work like that. It doesn't work like that. It doesn't work that God's just going to send you favor all the time in the mail, by telephone, through text and email and all of that good stuff. Listen, sometimes to work towards the promises and the favor of God, you're going to have to move. You're going to have to use some faith inside of yourself to move to something that doesn't make sense. You want me to walk through this dry land whenever there's a river being held up on this side right here? You want me to step foot in the middle of this? What if the water begins to rush over me? What if? Well, let me ask you a question. What did you have on this side? What did you have on this side that was so important? You see, people will spend lifetimes holding on to stuff that's not important. People will spend lifetimes over here going, well, this is the way we've always done it, always had it, always thought about it. Well, it's been working over here. What if what's working over here is holding you back from what's great over there? You ever think about that? It's working. I'm making it. I'm getting by. I'm doing this. I'm doing that. But what if working is just causing you to survive, but if you put a little faith and movement into it, you could thrive on this other side? What if you were not so worried or concerned about the waves or about the water or about what the timing or anything else? What if you dumbed down Christianity in such a way that you just said, if I believe, if I have faith, and if I follow, then anything is possible?
Amen.
Where along the way do we forget that? Where do we forget that? You can sit in a classroom today. I think they still, I don't know if they still do or not, I don't know, but you could sit in a classroom 10, 15, 20 years ago, kindergarten, first grade, whatever. You could read a book about little Timmy being an astronaut. And 10 out of 15 kids would want to be an astronaut. That's just how it was. Whenever I was 8 years old and I would watch Top Gun on repeat, twice a week, absolutely. I wanted a motorcycle. I had a bomber jacket, pair of Ray-Bans, and I wanted to be a naval aviator. That's what I wanted to be. I wanted to grow up and save the world. Lieutenant Pete Mitchell, that's who I wanted to be. Went and watched the second one, just as good as the first one. Highly recommended. Highly recommended. But whenever I was a kid, that's what I wanted to be. I thought and don't get me wrong, I'm not saying it wasn't possible, but you had to put in a lot of hard work to get it. You had to put in a lot of hard work to get it. But as I was a kid and I seen it, I was like, that's what I want to do. Couldn't nobody talk me out of it. That's what I want to do. That's what I want to be. But yet today, as adults, we come into this place jaded by the world. Whenever we look and we go, I want to do that. And the world will go, no, you're not good enough. You're not smart enough. You don't have enough money. You don't have the right last name. You're not from the right side of the tracks. You're not this, you're not that, you're not this, you're not that. And we get jaded by that. So when we come in on Sunday mornings and we're like, God can do anything in your life, you're like, yeah, right, whatever, Pastor. I still struggle. Newsflash, we all do.
Amen.
We all do. I'm not standing up here telling you today my life is perfect. It's far from it. I struggle just like everybody else does. But what I did come to tell you was that the fact of that I am not so much concerned as standing on the shore anymore. I'm not concerned about if I drown in the middle. I'm concerned about making it to the other side. Ain't that right, bro? Talk to me.
Yeah, you got time. Yeah, you got time.
I'm concerned about making it to the other side. So, the presence of God is at the edge. They're in the middle. Now, here we go. If we're in the middle, God wants you to do something while you're in the middle. That's just like God. I'm trying to make it safely to the other side of the shore in an expedient manner. I don't know how long this water's going to hold. I'm just going to rush. I'm just going to go. I'm just going to... Let me be very clear about that. Enjoy the process of the miracle.
Amen.
Enjoy it. Miracles, ladies and gentlemen, don't always happen overnight. It's not always like that. It's not always in those moments.
Sometimes miracles take days, weeks, months. Sometimes there's a buildup to the miracle. And we, through the process, well, gotta go right now, whatever commercial that is. What is it? Pepto Bismol? Shout out. Sorry. I didn't know who I was quoting. For all your stomach issues. Running and going, we gotta get through that process, man. We gotta get to the other side of the miracle so quick that we don't enjoy what God is doing. Whenever we start out with 8 people in the backyard, God's not going to give us 300 the next Sunday because we're not enjoying what God is doing. But piece by piece, moment by moment, family by family, person by person that comes in and walks in, then you begin to enjoy what God is doing through the process. And it's a miracle. Why is it a miracle? Why? Because we don't have any denominational backing. We don't get checks from anybody else. Everything that you see inside of this place has come by God's hand and God's hand alone. And every person that's set in here, I'll say it and I'll say it again, every person that is set inside of this place, 96% of y'all, we had never met before this church started. Enjoy the miracle. Enjoy what God is doing. Enjoy how He's doing it. He wants you to do something in the middle of it. I'm trying to get to the other side. Stop. Slow down. Hold up. I got something for you in the middle. What is it? What do you want me to do, God? I want you to pick up these stones. You still got those rocks in your hand?
Yeah.
If I say something bad, throw it at me. Throw it at us. Stop and pick up 12 stones. 12 stones is representative of the 12 tribes of Israel. Stop and pick up 12 stones. Each tribe, one person from each tribe picked up a stone. What that tells me is today, ladies and gentlemen, that God's favor is not just for one group of people. God's promises is not just for one group of people. God's favor, God's promises, God's breakthroughs, God's anointing is not just for one group of people. I want you to understand that it's for every person that sits inside of this place today. I don't care age, race, gender, it does not matter. God wants to pour out His blessings on your life. And He's showing you right here through Scripture that He wants everybody to be involved in the promises of God. Every single person, you're not excluded. You sinned before you walked in the door. Fantastic, we all did. You're still not excluded. You've not been in church in 10 years. Fantastic. A lot of people have it, but you're still not excluded. Oh, I've got 1,000 things happening in my life right now. Congratulations. You're still not excluded. You're still not excluded. The only way you will ever be excluded from the promises of God is if you exclude yourself. Amen. If you exclude yourself, no one else, so let's cut this out really quick, no one else can cut off the blessings of God from your life. Nobody. Except you. You decide. So watch this. I need you to stop in the middle and grab some stones. 12 of them to be exact. And then go on to the other side. I need you to stop in the middle. Why would you stop in the middle for God? Why would you stop us in the middle? Because most of the time, and maybe this is just logic and common sense, but most of the time, the middle is the deepest portion. So you want me to stop in the deepest portion to grab some rocks? Okay. Keep in mind, He's not even told them what they're going to do with them yet. I just want you to stop in the middle of the deepest point of the river and get some rocks. Now, that sound is always bad. I'm going to have to do something about that. Stop, get rocks in the middle, the deepest point, the deepest part of it. Stop and get them. And then take them on through with you.
Take them on through to the other side. Stop in the deepest point. Help me this morning. Help me. Find your deepest, lowest, darkest moment of your life. Find it. Find it. Strung out, broken, bankrupt, homeless, addicted. Where were you at? What moment was you in where you were just like, what moment? Here, let me ask you a question. Let's put it into perspective and put it real. At what moment was you thinking about just ending it all and taking your own life? Let's put it at that moment. Because that's when it gets real. That's when it gets serious. What moment was that at? Because that's the deepest moment of your river. That's the deepest moment of your process. That's the deepest moment and the darkest moment of your life. And God, before He takes you out of it, says, need you to grab a rock. Makes no sense. I was going to grab a gun, God, but I need you to grab a rock. I was going to grab a needle, but I need you to grab a rock. Grab a knot. Is it too graphic yet? I want to be real with you. I need you to grab a rock instead. Well, that's going to be painful, God. I don't want it to kill you. I want you to remember it. Now we're going somewhere. I want you to remember it. I want you to remember. You still got that rock in your hand? All right, here's how you're going to remember it. I want you to just take that rock and just rub it around in your hand just for a little bit. Take that rock and just rub it around in your hand just for a minute. Because here's the thing about it. You sat inside of this place today, ain't you? So by all accounts, God replaced your gun and that bullet with this rock. God replaced that razor blade with this rock. God replaced that needle with this rock. God replaced whatever was about to take you out with this rock right here. And He said, I need you to carry it with you. Why? Why? Why would I carry this rock with me for, Lord? It's stupid. So much of this stuff that this pastor gets up here, he's handed out boards on Sundays. He's handed out rocks now. He's handed out flip-flops. This stuff is silly. No, it's a reminder to make the Scripture come to life in your life. We handed out flip-flops one Sunday in this place with Scripture on it. Why? Because the Bible says that the Israelites wandered in the wilderness for 40 years, but their clothes never had holes and their shoes were never worn. That's how good God is. So now you got a brand new pair of flip-flops to wear to understand that God's goodness outweighs your dumbness. Yeah. You hand out planks of wood because Paul floated in on the other side because God's not done with you yet. Right. You hand out rocks on Sunday to understand. To understand when God tells you to stop in the middle of your lowest point of your life. When He's trying to do a miracle, stop and pick up something to remind you of where He found you. Amen. Because as Christians in 2022, we have choice. We can take these rocks and we can build altars and we can pray. Or we can take rocks and we can use them as weapons and start throwing them at other people. Help me. Help me. We can take these rocks right here, because here's the reminder. If you can't be reminded of where you've been, as soon as you cross paths with a person who's in the same shape or worse shape as what you was, if you can't remember, you start judging instead of praying. Oh, man, if you would have done this, if you would have done that, if you would have made this decision, if you would have been here, you start passing judgment because you don't remember where God found you. You don't remember the lowest point of your life. You don't remember being in the miry clay. You don't remember drowning. You don't remember almost taking your life, taking your last breath. You don't remember those moments. Now you're on the other side, but can I tell you, even promised land, people still got problems. People still got problems.
And as we hold on to these are not weapons, they're a reminder. They're a reminder of how far God has brought you, of where God found you, and how far He's brought you. So that whenever you cross a person that is in the same situation or worse, instead of bouncing to point A and going, well, let me tell you how bad you suck, you pull out that rock and go, I used to be here. I used to be in that same situation. Now I'm reminded. Now I'm reminded to treat people with grace. Now I'm reminded to treat people with love. Now I'm reminded to treat people because somebody believed in me. Now I'm where I am today. Now I'm where I am today. And I can tell you, people would be a whole lot further along if they knew that there was a God who loved them versus a church that judged them.
Amen.
That's Instagram worthy. Much further along would people be if instead of throwing, we built an altar and prayed.
Yeah.
Lord, help these people. Lord, help them to feel the love that I feel. Help them to feel the grace that I feel. Help them to feel the forgiveness that I feel. Help them to feel like there's a chance, that there's a meaning to life. Help them feel like that, Lord. Because now I do. Now I do. The priest carrying the chest continued standing there until everything that Joshua had instructed to do was done. Now I want you to get this last part right here. It says, the people crossed. No one dawdled. Everybody crossed. No one dawdled. What does that mean? It means everybody moved at the same time. They didn't hesitate, right, Miss Janice? Everybody moved at the same time. I want to put this as simplistic as I can. We are losing a tug of war with the devil because we're not moving at the same time. I hate to tell you this, but let me take it back to elementary school for you. There was two people you put on the end of that rope. The biggest, I give a PG, the biggest or the strongest. Why? Because you wanted your anchor in the back. Because when everybody else got top, at least that anchor in the back's going to be here long enough for people to regain their strength and their energy. Can I tell you, the anchor doesn't make a difference if nobody else is pulling. It doesn't make a difference. So, you got your strongest on the back, but nobody's pulling with you. And now the devil's pulling every bit of momentum you have in the opposite direction because nobody's moving at the same time. Nobody's moving at the same time. I don't care if your church has, what do we have today, Julie? 114? That's great. 114. I don't care if we have 114 in here. If these 114 that are sitting in here are not working together, we're accomplishing nothing.
Amen.
We're accomplishing nothing. Nothing at all. We've got to be on the same page in this process or else we're accomplishing nothing. Nothing at all. No one dawdled. No one just stood around. No one was left behind. Because sometimes we can get so distracted. The church is... The church is moving forward, but the members are staying stuck. Let me be very blunt. You're not growing a church just because you're growing your members. Church is not based on numbers. Church is not based on numbers. That's why you have churches with 300, 500, 2,000 that couldn't pray themselves out of a wet paper bag. Boy, we are shooting up satellite campuses everywhere, 15 different ones. This woman needs healing. You better tell her to go find somebody. Okay. Your church grows as your members grow. Not in number, but in faith. And in understanding. In understanding and faith. No one dawdled. No one stayed behind. No one. The most difficult part of my job is making this message comprehensible to everyone. That's the most difficult part. Because there's people that sits in here that's like, this is so underneath me. And then there's some people that sit in here and it's like, I still didn't get it. I ain't pointing you out. Yet. But it's putting it on a level where we're all growing at the same time. And I want to say this and then I'm closing down. Don't match your growth to someone else's gains. Don't match it. Comparison is the quickest thief of joy. And when I look over at the next person, and they over here laying in the floor flopping, mascara going everywhere, Jesus really working in their life. And I'm over here on the other side like, I didn't even understand what that scripture said. And I just give up and walk out. I've compared my growth to someone else's. And that's the quickest way to stop growing. That's the quickest way. Stop comparing. Be thankful of the journey that God's got you on. Be thankful for where you came from. Be thankful for where God has brought you from. Be thankful because you want to know why. Hey, you're not dead. You're not dead. You could be dead. But you're not. You still living, you came to church, and you got a rock for it today. Life is good. Life is good. Life is good. Very many churches don't give you something for showing up. You got a lot. Life is good. It says, they carried these rocks across and he set them down. And Joshua set up the 12 stones taken from the middle of the Jordan and had marked the place where the priest who carried the chest of the covenant had stood. And they were still there. You want to know why they set these rocks up for? As a reminder. Set them up as a reminder. If you go on and read in scripture, the reminder was for them to talk because it says, the Bible says that their children would ask them one day, what does these stones mean? What does these stones mean? Oh, these, man, I almost called this sermon today, if the stones could tell a story. If the stones could tell a story. What are you doing with these stones? What does these stones mean? Let me tell you a story about how good God's been in my life. Let me tell you about where God's brought me from and where he's taken me to. Let me tell you about the deepest, lowest, craziest point in my life where I thought nothing else could go wrong. Let me tell you about that. These stones serve as a reminder. And you know what? They serve as a reminder that we have a responsibility to tell our kids about who Jesus is.
Amen.
And what he can do. What he's about. These stones are to give hope to the next generation. To look at them and go, you know what? I was in a bad way. But Jesus reached down and saved my life. Jesus reached down and took care of me. Jesus brought me out of the lowest point and he put me on the other side so I could receive the promises of God. My goodness gracious. The stones are a reminder. Stand with me. I was legitimately excited about this message today. I get excited about every message, but I was legit excited today, man, because it really made me understand. It really made me understand that sometimes we have to get to the lowest points of our lives before we learn to look up, before we learn to trust, before we learn to call out and say, God, help me. God, show me. And just because you make it to the other side doesn't mean you're perfect. Doesn't mean you're never going to have a need again. What it means is that you found grace to get to the other side. And there's going to be more valleys in life, and there's going to be more hard times and more trouble and more situations that arise. But if God did it once, he can do it again. If God's brought you out once, he can bring you out again. If God brought you out of the deepest, darkest, lowest point, let this be a reminder today that God still got your back. He's still working in your life. Now, I know y'all don't follow directions very well. Get it. You're people. Here's what I want today. On this side, let's see if I can make it very, very plain where everybody follows directions. On this side, as we have this altar call, if you're in the moments of your life right now, you may be in the middle of the Jordan at the deepest point. Dark, messed up, addicted, broken, whatever the case is. But you're in the middle of it right now. And you're like, Lord, I just want to be able to trust you. And I want to get to the other side. I want to get out of the mess that I'm in. I want to feel life again. I want to wake up and actually have joy and peace in my life. If you're in the middle of that Jordan, at this very moment right here, as we do this altar call, I want you to come here because I want to pray with you today. I want people to pray with you today. I want you to feel and know that you're not going to be left behind. You're not going to be left behind. Well, Keenan, if that's one side of the stage, what's this side of the stage going to be for? Lord, I need you to remind me. I need you to remind me, Lord, of where I used to be at. Sometimes you need a dose of reality, don't you? Sometimes you need to be reminded of where you started at, where God found you at. A ditch, back of a building somewhere. Where did God find you at? Where did you finally call out to him at? Where did you finally call out? Where did he find you? You just need to say, Lord, I thank you that I'm not where I used to be. I always say, if you're not where you used to be, but you're not where you want to be, you're right where you need to be.
Amen.
Right where you need to be. If that's you, I need you on this side. As they play, sing a little bit, we're going to open this altar up. Think about it. Think about it. Let the Spirit move in your life. Think about it. If that's you, two sides.
We're not going to take very long. But if that's you, come on. Let's come to the altar. Let's pray about it. Come on. We know who you are. get. I want you to see, I want you to get this. That as we go together, we grow together. And as we grow together, we get more powerful together through this whole process. Through this whole process. I can't tell you or even put into words how proud I am. How proud we are as pastors, as church leaders, as ministers, to watch a group of people who says, I'm not there anymore, walk over and start praying for people who's in the middle of the worst times in their life. You don't understand it, but it's growth. Nobody had to tell you to do it. It's just what you went and done. That's growth. That's growth. Be proud of yourself today. Be proud of yourself today. Everybody that sits in this house right now, if you've not been here before, this is what we always do at the end. We take 45 seconds, a minute, whatever, really quick. If there's anybody that just wants to say thank you, Jesus, thank you, Jesus. If there's anybody that just wants to say thank you, Jesus, really quick before we go. Anybody got a word on their heart before we walk out of this place? Anybody? Tell me, Roland, what you got? Say it one more time. Say thank you, Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Anybody else in this house? What you got, Ian? Thank you, Jesus. Hey, don't let these kids outpraise you.
I just want to say I'm thankful to be here. Thankful God saved my soul.
Amen. Amen.
And as old as I am, as we're shopping around, this is truly an amazing sight, amazing feeling. And it's very humbling to see this group of people come together and worship like this.
Amen.
You don't get that everywhere, do you?
Amen.